Thank you for the introduction. So I got the first part, but I don't know what you said after that. Okay, welcome. By the way, this nice picture belongs to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, and they published close to 400,000 pictures into public domain. You can go to the website and just download all of them. Yeah, you already introduced me. My name is Andreas Scherbaum, work for a company called Pivotal, and I'm also board of directors for Postgres Europe. So we organize a yearly conference or an annual conference across Europe, other conferences like PG Day, FOSDEM, and so on. You can find me on my Twitter account here, and on my website I have all of my slides and talks. You can go and download. Good. This talk is for you if you know a few data types in Postgres, if you know how to use them, but if you're eager to learn more about them. If you're reading Hacker's Mailing List daily, it's probably not the right talk for you. Okay, first question, if we talk about data types. How many data types do we have in Postgres? Any opinions? 16. 60. 40. Any other opinions? Yes? Yeah, it's called PG type. If you look into PG type, in my database it says 361. However, it also includes a row for every table you have, because every time you create a table in Postgres, it also creates a row type, which has an exact structure like this table. So we have to include this, we have to exclude all of these. We still end up with 82 data types in Postgres, basic data types, more than any one of you guessed. That's, by the way, a full list, excluding all the other ones, table types. Luckily, we also have a nice documentation in Postgres. So if you go to the Postgres website, click on documentation, you see this complete list and a short explanation what it does. And it still only lists 41 of them, not all 82. I don't know how much time you have, but we want to look into 41 of them. No, we only look at a few ones here. This gets me to my next question. How many data types do you know in Postgres? Any opinion? Most of 41, okay, you are close. Any other? Come again? Okay, let's see what we have. That's why we are here. Yeah, we have a number of text types, numeric types, data time, and so on. And we look into this few, so I don't cover all of them here, only the basic ones, and it's still enough to talk an hour about it. Let's start with text types. In Postgres, we have varchar, char, and text, and basically it's all the same. Internally, it's the same data type. It can store roughly a gigabyte of data. And if you want to do composition with text types, you have to be aware that it's case sensitive. So if you want to have a case insensitive composition, you have to use I-like instead of like. It stores, as I said, up to roughly a gigabyte of data. It can compress it. Varchar and char, you can specify your length. If you do not specify your length, Varchar will just store everything up to a gigabyte. If you do not specify your length for char, it will only store one byte. Most likely not what you want. And there's a slight difference how char and Varchar handle white spaces. So white spaces in Varchar, Postgres will cut them off at the end. If you have a char, it will just keep them. As an example here, I have five white spaces, and I cast them to different types. And you can see if you have a varchar, you end up with only having five white spaces, no matter how much you cast it or how long you cast it. If you have a char, it will actually fill up this char up to the number of characters you specify. So it will add more if required. That's the only difference between char and varchar here. Okay, how does Postgres store 1 gigabyte of text or data or whatever you have? Internally, if you have a text data type or any table you have, it stores in pages, and every page by default is 8 kilobyte. And one row in a table has to fit in one page. So it cannot exceed a page. So how do you store 1 gigabyte in 8 kilobyte? How good is the compression? The way Postgres does it is any time you have a text type, or for that matter, any type which has a variable length, it uses a pointer. In your table, you only have a 4-byte pointer into a so-called toast table. And in your toast table, you can use as many rows as required, up to 1 gigabyte. So this has an advantage that we only use 4 bytes here, and we have a static write for our row. So every row in a table has the same write. It's not getting bigger or smaller. And every row fits into our 8 kilobyte page. So, speaking of text, many times I migrated from mostly MySQL databases. I found columns where I had a varchar 255 or similar in my table definition. Is there any reason for having this arbitrary number of 255? Well, not in Postgres. But if you look around, or if I looked around, I found a number of results in Google and search code and so on, and all of them are actually MySQL projects. So many people coming from MySQL, or many people using MySQL, seem to think it's a good idea to actually use 255 as a text length in the database. I don't know why. If you know, please let me know. Actually, there's one reason in MySQL, because if you use InnoDB as an index key, it can store up to 3 times 255 in an index. That's the only reason I found why they use 255. Good. Anytime you have a question, please just raise a hand. We answer them right away. Okay, numeric types. We have 3 different numeric types in Postgres. It's integer, and for integers we have integer with 2 bytes, 4 bytes, and 8 bytes. We have floating point numbers, and we have a numeric type. If we look into the detail, for an integer 2, we can store anything between minus 32k up to plus 32k. If we have a regular integer, which is an integer with 4 bytes, we can store minus 2 billion up to plus 2 billion, so it's always signed. And if we use a big integer, we can store 9, whatever, minus 2 plus. Keep in mind, the database will actually align this type to a 4-byte boundary. So I have a table, let's say a small int and an integer and a small int and an integer. It will always use a 4-byte boundary here, because integer starts with 4 bytes, or integer is 4 bytes. It's not a big deal if you have a few thousand rows, but if you store a few 100 million rows, having a difference of 4 bytes is actually a big deal. We're talking about several hundred megabytes here. So by just reordering my columns, small int, and then I have my boundary of 4, and my other 2 integers, I actually save 4 bytes. Is this a question? No. Okay, we also have floating point numbers with 4 bytes and with 8 bytes. And for floating point numbers, you have to keep in mind it is always a rounded number. It's never the exact number you typed in or you sent to the database. Internally, it's always stored as a base and an exponent. Giving you an example here. So this one is a real. I'm using 6 digits here. It looks like it's really using 6 decimal digits, but internally it's stored. So once I make it 7 digits here, you see it's using a base and an exponent. And that's how it's stored in a database. So if I try to use 7 digits here, but have a decimal point, you see it actually starts rounding my number. So please don't store any money values or numbers which must be precise in a floating point numbers. The database will round it. The same is true for double precision here. So I have 15 digits. It looks like it is exact, but it's rounded. And once I either start adding another digit or just using a decimal point here, it starts rounding my number. So what can we do if we actually want to store a large number and it must be precise? We have another data type, which is called numeric. Numeric data type has a precision up to 1,000 digits. Anyone has a use case for 1,000 digits? I don't. By the way, we also have a money type in Postgres, but please don't use this one. There are like 2 people in the world actually using it. Internally, it's a numeric, but it also comes with a currency attached. And you can only have 1 currency. Whatever you define in as the monetary in your operating system, this is a currency used in your money type. There is no transformation between 2 different currency or so ever, so it's really only a fixed use case. There's no need to use a money type here. But it can store whatever the US has as debt, so it's large enough. Let's go back to numeric. As I said, numeric has 1,000 digits precision, and it's defined by defining the whole number of digits you're going to use, plus the number of digits after the decimal point. So in this case here, I have 7 digits before and 3 after. 7 plus 3 is 10, and 3 after decimal point. And numeric is handled in software. So it's not like an integer, which just gets loaded into a CPU register and can be added in like 1 takt cycle. It's a bit slower, but it's precise. Anyone know this guy? 1, 2, okay, who is it? Anyone knows this person? No. Anyone been to India? You never met him? Maybe. Okay, about how many wise grains are we talking about? How many? Yeah. So we are talking about 1, 2, 4, 8. We double the number of wise grains on every field of the chessboard. And in total, we are talking about 2^64 - 1. So if we use a double precision number, we see, okay, that's not very exact. It starts rounding this number, or we can't store the number of waste grains in a double precision number, which is the biggest floating point number we have. But if we use numeric, you see it's only using 20 digits. We still have 980. Well, that's one use case to use numeric here. Okay, we also have a sequence. Anyone familiar with sequences? It's like an auto-increment in Oracle or MySQL databases. So we attach a sequence to a column, and any time you do not specify a value for this column, Postgres will just pick a next value from a sequence. Very convenient. Sequences by default start with 1 and increase by 1, but you can change both of it. So you can actually start with a higher value, or you can have a step of like 5, or you can step backwards, counting from a number backwards. All of this works. Again, we have a sequence for every numeric for every integer data type we have. So small serial is 2 bytes, can actually only count up to plus 32k. Then we have an integer serial type up to 2 billion. And we have a big scale which can up to 9 something, very large number. Keep in mind, a sequence in Postgres is not transactional. Anytime you got a value from a sequence, it's not given back if you roll back a transaction. So like you insert 50,000 values in a table or 100,000 and you roll back your transaction, the next transaction will actually get 50,000 plus 1. So you have a large gap here. Which is okay if you're just interested in the primary key, because it will be unique. It's not okay if you have to have continuous numbers and you need to find another way to calculate this number. We have a number of functions to use sequences here. With current wall, you can select what is the current value of the sequence in my current session. So even though you can have like 5 different connections fetching values from a sequence, this will always give back the current value used in your own session. So the last one you used. With next wall, you can fetch the next value from a sequence. And with set wall, you can set a new value. Like as I mentioned before, you fetch 50,000 rows, you roll back a transaction, and you have a large gap. You can actually reset this gap by just selecting the max ID from your table and setting this as a new value of your sequence. Keep in mind, if someone else fetched a value from a sequence in the meantime and you reset this to a lower value, then at some point you will get a collision because someone else used this ID and the sequence is not keeping tab on used IDs. It's just providing the next ID here. And there's a function which can return you the name of a sequence attached to a table. pgetCSequence accepts a table name and a column name and will return you the name of a sequence. Usually when it's created by Postgres itself, it's table name, column name, underscore sequence, but you can create a sequence on your own. So don't rely on this name. Actually use this function here and fetch the name of a sequence if you have to use a sequence name somewhere. And a sequence is yet another table in Postgres. You can select from it. Select star from my sequence name gives you all the GUI details, like what is my current value, what's the name of course, what's my increment, so what's my step, is it counting forward or backward, does it run over. What is this? Any opinions? South Pole, anyone else? How do you know? It looks like. Well, it actually says here 90 degrees south. So it must be South Pole. Okay, what's the time at South Pole right now? Who of you is using Postgres? No. No. Okay, let's find out because Postgres can tell you. You have a time zone built in, time zone database built in. Okay, in Postgres we have a number of date and time types. So we have timestamp without time zone and we have timestamp with time zone. So they are like two parties. Some people prefer to really store everything in UTC time zone. Don't use any time zone at all and just do calculations on the fly. Other people tend to store everything using time zone and let Postgres do the calculation. Whatever you do, both are right. We also have a time data type with and without time zone. It only stores a time, not a date. And we have a date type, which only stores a date and obviously no time zone. An interval in Postgres is the difference between two date types. We can actually do mathematical calculations between dates and types here. I'll show you a few examples. Postgres is able to deal with daylight saving time if you actually specify a time zone. So here in Russia a while back, I think you at some point moved to summertime and then stopped using daylight saving time. Postgres knows about it, or actually the time zone database on your computer knows about it, and Postgres can use this information to calculate the correct time. It will not deal with any leap seconds. Like from time to time, either on New Year's Eve or in July, we have a leap second. This is not stored somewhere in a time zone database. So Postgres doesn't know about it. So let's look into it. I have a date, I cast it to a timestamp, and you see Postgres returns just midnight of the same date because I made it a timestamp and not a date. It can also recognize text formats like the CVS format here, month, day, and year. It again returns midnight. I can specify a time zone. So it's 3:25 UTC, Greenwich time, and it actually returns 5:25. Why? Well, Postgres always will return a time in your current time zone. And by current time zone, it's the time zone of the server. That's why some people prefer to just set every server to UTC and don't deal with this problem. Well, it's up to you. Another example, it's December here. This server is actually set to European summer time, so that's why it's 2 hours difference in summer, in August, and 1 hour difference in December, in winter. Another example, it's 12th of April, midnight in Moscow, will return us 2 hours before in Berlin. So Postgres knows about time zones. I specified a time zone name here, and it does a correct calculation back to my own time zone. Then again, I can just specify a time zone by using a number, and of course a number has no daylight saving time information. So it's always just plus four. So in a transaction, if I start a transaction in Postgres, time stops. If you use select now several times, you will always see the same time. And I use this here, select now, I get 1:55 here. I set a new time zone, so I'm no longer in Berlin now. I switch to Moscow, and you see it's 3:55 now. Postgres calculated the timestamp into the new time zone I specified. That's one way to change time zones. That's one way to actually change my output here. But it looks a bit complicated, right? You have to start a transaction. You have to set a new time zone. Please don't forget to reset your time zone to whatever you want to use next. There must be an easier way. Well, every time you deal with a time, you can also specify a time zone. Like here, select now, add time zone Moscow. That easy. So just for this one value, Postgres will return my time in Moscow time. And keep tab on if it's summer or winter time. So if this is a time, it's January here, this is 2017, yes, it's still summertime in Russia. If you go 10 years back, it will be winter time. Okay, we can also do time zone calculations or time calculations here. 2005th of January minus 2001st of January gives me an interval of 4 days. So we have 4 days difference between these two dates. I turn it around, 1st of January minus 4th of January, I get minus 3 days. I can also not only use dates, I can also use times here. You see between these two timestamps, it's 10 days, 17 hours, and so on, difference. Again, Postgres keeps tab on time zones. You can actually specify a different time zone for any, for both of these timestamps here, and will do the correct math. Oh, February 28 plus interval of 1 day. No, I turn it around. I use a date plus an interval. Postgres will return another date. And in a leap year, it's 29th of February. So anyone questioning that 2000 was a leap year? Well, then Postgres is wrong. It is a leap year if it's if you can divide it by 4, not by 100, but by 400. Yeah. So Postgres is right? Yes. And 2001, 1st of January, minus 2000, 1st of January, gives me 360 days difference. 2002, minus 2001, gives me 365 difference. Okay, coming back to my question, what time is it at South Pole? There's a station next to South Pole, it's called Scott Amundsen. How many Americans do we have in the room? How many Americans do we have in the room? Just you. Okay, Scott Amundsen is United States, but it's supplied from New Zealand because it's closer. And for convenience, they use the same time zone as New Zealand. And by now, we know how to calculate a time zone or timestamp or current time of New Zealand. Select now at time zone NZ. Is that easy? Well, we are still cheating because it's New Zealand. We can do Antarctica. There's actually a time zone in your computer which is called Antarctica South Pole. And I think Russia has a station down there as well. Anyone knows the name? I don't. And they're using the same time zone as Moscow. So basically it's arbitrarily defined time zones and they are like 11 or 12 stations on Antarctica and each of them is using the time zone as their own capital city. Good. Anyone using XML? What are you using XML for? Everything. Okay, please migrate to JSON. Anyone, Postgres can store XML data and not only like a text string, but it can actually validate XML. By using the correct encoding, you can have Postgres actually transform encoding between UTF-8, usually used internally, and whatever you use in the application. As I said before, it can validate the text, but you cannot search into an XML type, except using very basic things like or ilike or such or regex. But there's no real search functionality for XML. That's how it looks like if you store a Word document, XML document in an XML type. So you see, it returns all the correct quotes and text and everything. We can also store just a few pieces of XML, like just one tag here, in an XML type in Postgres. Again, it does a validation. It will not allow me to store this text here if I forgot my closing tag. It will just bail out with an error, but I cannot search in it. So it's a very limited functionality. For the real game, we have JSON in Postgres. Anyone here using JSON or JSONB? Let's turn the question around. Anyone not using JSON? What is this? Okay, that's just wrong. We have a JSON data type in Postgres, which was originally used for web applications. Now it's used between like everything, Internet of Things devices, transport data, exchange data, between everything. What you can't see here because it's broken, we actually have two JSON types in Postgres. One is called JSON, which stores the data as it comes in and does no parsing. And we have a JSONB for binary data type, which will parse the data when it comes in and stores it in a parsed format in a database. To use JSON in Postgres, we actually have to quote a JSON string using double quotes here and single quotes for Postgres. It's a bit complicated, but you get used to it. If I cast this to a JSON B type here, and you see, I still get a quoted text back. That's a JSON string. I can also store an array, like I create my array here. It's still, for Postgres, it's still a text until it gets cast to JSON. I have my three values, and you see, I get the full array back with three strings in it. Or I can create key value pairs, having my keys here, 1, 2, 3, and values as a text here. So it's a weird thing I also use in other NoSQL databases like Cassandra, MongoDB, and so on. I can also search in my JSON. Here in this example, I want to see if the key 2 is in my element. And you see, I get my element 2 back. If it's not in my element because I have no schema, I just get a null value back. I can also find out if a specific value is in my list by using this add operator here. It's very important if you use schema-less types like JSON. You don't really know if a specific element is in there or not, because someone else can have expanded this element or can basically store anything. So you have to verify whatever data you're looking for is actually in your data, every single time. Postgres can do it for you. So you don't have to pull all of this out of the database and do the validation in your application. You can do it in the database. So here, I want to verify if GHA is in my element here. So it is, so I get a 2 back. Or I want to verify if DEF is in my element here, I get a 2 back. In this case here, it's if the value is in my list, or here, if the key exists in my list. Not really looking at a value, but if a specific key is defined. And I can also create an index on a specific element, which speeds up my queries. In this example here, I have my table, I have my column, and in my data column, in my table, there's supposed to be a name column in JSON. And on this name column, I can create an index using this format, using gin index here. And now, if I search for a specific name column in my JSON, this is actually answered from my index. So I don't have to scan my entire table, millions of rows. I just look into my index if a specific value is there or not. You can imagine that's very fast. So any questions for JSON? I mean, we can spend like an hour just talking on JSON. It's just a quick overview here. If not, let's move on. Anyone using a Boolean type? True. Anyone using true and false and not using a Boolean type? Good. Because we have some databases which define a Boolean type. I'm not saying any names, MySQL. They have a Boolean type defined, but it's an integer or small integer actually under the hood. And you end up not only having 0 and 1, but things like 3 and 5 and 7 in your table. Now what is a 7 in Boolean? I don't know, but you have to migrate it, so find out. So in Postgres, we have a real Boolean type, which returns true and false. It accepts a number of additional values, like 1 and T and Y and yes and so on. But in the end, you only get true and false back. Very easy. So I have my true value here, cast it to Boolean. You see I get T and F back. I cannot really, or I couldn't really figure out why it says T and F and not 0 and 1, but well, that's what it is. But I have a nice use case for you. Let's say you have a log table, millions of rows, billions of rows, and usually if you store logs, there might be an error or might not be an error. So I have a flag here for my error. Most of my rows very likely don't have an error, so I'm not really interested in them, except for audit reasons. I create a bunch of rows here, just random rows, and for 2% of them, I actually set my error flag to true. For the other 98%, I set it to false. So I end up with having 1 million rows, and roughly 20,000 of them are an error. If I look into my table, I'm really only interested in this 2%. And I can have an index speeding up things. So that's a regular select where I look for any error row here, and you see it's very expensive. Cost of 16,000 something. I can speed this up. I can actually create a conditional index which only contains all the rows where error is true, because I'm only interested in a 2%, not a 98. And you see, now using this index, my cost comes down to 68. And to give you a comparison of what you save, I have a full index as well. So my full index actually has 2,745 pages. My conditional index has 57 pages. And out of the 2,745 pages, I'm not interested in 2,690. So I don't need to store the 98% here. I can use a conditional index to just look for my 2%. Anyone using bits data types? What for? Well, what's your use case? So we have a bit data type in Postgres as well, not only Boolean, where you have really only one value in a column, but in bits you can store as many bits as you specify. And you can do all kind of logical operations on bits, like you know from any programming language. And I can Postgres tell, okay, this is a bit type here. I don't have to do the math and do it on my own, and just tell Postgres, yeah, I put a B in front of it, and now these are bits. And will do the math for me. Okay, here I have an AND example, my data from my column and a bit type where only one bit is set. So my result is it's only one when both bits on both sides are set. So I had like 10101 here, and here I only have one set, so I end up with my result only the white bit is set. Same with OR, using a pipe. Anything is set because either one bit on the left side or one bit on the right side is set. Exclusive order, either one bit on the left or one bit on the right, but not both are set. And I can also do math, so I can shift my bits to the left or to the right here, using these double arrows. And you see my original data was 21, shifted one to the left, I end up getting 42 multiplied by 2. I can also search in my bits. It's probably not something what you want to do if you just store bits, but well, you can do it. So I have my data column here. I search logical AND all the rows where my left by white bit, so my first bit is set. I actually have to cast it to an integer here, because I need a true false comparison in Postgres. And I get my row where the first bit is set. If I try the same with my second bit set, you see no result because, well, it's not set in both values. I can also have Postgres cast all different types to any other type. You've seen it before. I can cast to bit. I have an integer here. I tell Postgres, okay, I want a bit here. And you see I get my bit output. It doesn't only work with bit, it also works with hex values, so Postgres can do all of it. Good, anyone storing binary data in a database? Why? What? Images. And you? Okay. legacy. So you're going to migrate too? Anyway, yeah, we can do it. What's the problem with storing binary data in Postgres? Well, we have a text type, it can fit 1 gigabyte. Postgres is written in C. How does C handle strings? It doesn't, not really. But anytime you have a bit or a byte where no bit is set, binary zero, for C, it's end of a string. So if you want to send data to the database and there's binary data in it, there's a high chance that there's a byte where no bit is set. That's the end of your query string. You get a parse error. Postgres works around the problem by using byte A, and byte A does specify a length of your binary data, and then just stores the binary data. So you say, okay, I have 517 bytes. That's the first four bytes you use for storing the length. Then you just store 517 bytes, and you don't look for an end of string. You just know it's 517 bytes. That's how you store the data. So any programming language you can use with Postgres or as a client application has functions to store and retrieve binary data. Please use them. Please don't write your own wrapper. I've seen it before. Postgres has two different types or ways to output binary data. The new format is called hex, and the old format is called escape. When does it change, Marcus? 9.3? So the new format is hex, and it's the default now. This E here tells Postgres, in this string coming next, there's an escape. If you don't specify it E, this E, it will work, but it will emit a warning in a log file that you used an escape in your string. So might someone try to escape your query string. Okay, anyone storing network data in Postgres? What for? What's the use case? Okay. Network location, okay. Magnus, you? What's your use case? Well, whatever. Okay, now I'm worried. How do you handle the big data here? Okay, we have three different types for storing network data here. It's not geodata, it's network data. So we have an INET type, which can store an IPv4 or IPv6 address, and a network mask. We have a CDDR type, which only stores a network mask, not an IP address, and a MAC address type, which stores a MAC address, so it's 6 bytes. Give you some examples here. I specify a single IP address and a network mask. It's 256 IP addresses. Well, it's stored as it is. If you do not specify a network mask, Postgres will make a best guess. So here I get my IP address /32, which is a single host address. Here I only specify 3 octets, and Postgres makes a best guess and thinks, okay, this looks like you're storing a 24/256 IP addresses here. And it completes my part of the IP address to a full network address here. On the bright side, you can also use an index on top of an INET type. So you don't have to do all kind of string parsing and is this IP address the other one. You can actually let Postgres do all the dirty work here. I have a table with an INET type. I create an index on it, on this column, and I insert a few values. Two of them out of the 192-168 range and one out of the 10 range. And now I can search if a specific IP address or a specific range is in my table. Like here, I want to find any IP address which is in this given range, all 256 of them. And it's supported by my index, and I get two of my three IP addresses in my table back. Well, as I said, it's supported by index. Good. Last but not least, you can create your own data types in Postgres. Just a quick overview. Anyone did this before? Except the usual suspects? We have a number of ways how to do this. So you can use a composite type. You can use an enumeration type. You can also write your very own data type using a few C functions and so on. I pick one here, an enumeration type, just to give you an example. Anytime you have a static list of values, you can use an enum to make life a bit easier. If you think the static list might change, so it's not really static, please use a lookup table. How many different gender values do you know?
27.
27. Any other? So Facebook defines 56. It's probably more. So there's a whole ISO standard talking about this. So if you think you can actually implement a static list of gender values for application, well, think again. Okay, anyone knows the card games? It's a very perfect example for a static list because this will never change. You can actually define a type. Diamonds, hearts, spades, clubs. And then you can use this type you defined here like any other data type in Postgres in your table. Not only for inserting the values, but also for searching in your values here. Makes life easy. You don't have to join tables and do lookups. Okay, there's plenty more missing. I don't have time to cover it. It's topics for another talk here. And thank you. Any questions?
Any questions?
Example with sequences where you get max ID from table to initialize sequence. What if table has no rows at all?
Then you get a null value back, and I don't know. Probably the universe explodes.
Set next value as undef.
Yes, you get null back. Yeah. You can't update. You can't update a sequence.
Your query will raise an error, or what?
Yes, it will raise an error. Yes. Well, this example was really to show that you can update a sequence using a max value in a table. Well, if you have no values at all, your sequence probably stays at one.
Thank you.
We have time for one or two questions. Anyone?
Thanks for the pitch. Regarding time zones, imagine that tomorrow I have a new rule, for example, in the major country ABC, which will force to, you know, adjust different rules for switching between DST and standard time. So this information will be pulled from the system, or I need to wait for a new Postgres version to make it available, or how it works?
No, Postgres will pull this information from your time zone database. Postgres itself has no knowledge about time zones. It will look up information in time zone database.
Okay. Thank you.
Andreas, would you prefer enum or domain? Because they're kind of similar there. You can create a domain.
I can create a domain, yes. Yeah. I actually never use them. I know some people who use them heavily, but no.
Okay.
So thank you a lot.
Thank you.